Guess we'll see.
It's one way to find out. Put you right on the spot. There she is, Joelle, live. And you gotta find you. Hey everybody, how are you? It's Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training with my What Would Jeff Do Dog Training Show of the Week with a special guest, Joelle. And we're trying to figure out, we're borrowing Linda's computer, and it's right there. And that means we got her. And let's turn up your volume. And you can hear me, so you're speaking. Everybody can hear me. If you can hear me, everybody can hear me. So then all you're doing is you're like right there. I got it? All right, everybody. How are you? My name is Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. This is my What We Do dog training show. And actually, it's 2 times a week. Not every week, guys. Don't hold me to it. And if Joelle feels like she's like a prisoner right now, and like, Jeff, she looks like she's a prisoner and you're holding her against your will, it's because she's like, because that's how I feel. She walked in here normally the last couple of times. Joelle's been with me for what, about a month now? Mm-hmm. Joelle's down from New Hampshire. She's from Canines in Focus in New Hampshire, and she's an up-and-coming dog trainer. She's spending a 3-month internship with me. She's been here for a month, and she's always invited to come in and sit on these, and we do different mentoring sessions on business and social media and personal growth. But she's always on the opposite side of us. So she's like, I'm safe. I don't have to be in front of the camera. And a couple of things. Number one, she didn't realize that Linda and I normally don't wear pants during our show. So she's like, oh, well, if I would have known that, I would have done it earlier. So she's obviously super uncomfortable. And then she's sitting next to me, which obviously makes most people uncomfortable. So what she's going to do is she's going to read the questions. I'm going to give the answers. The format's the same. I might have to remind her, Joelle, speak up, because she's not used to doing this. She has started doing her own social media, which is really, really hard to do. Getting in front of a camera is really difficult to do. I would probably say one of the hardest things probably of your is your internship so far is not the dog training part.
Yeah.
It's me pushing you.
Yep.
Yeah.
It is.
With like videos and getting out of your comfort zone and putting your stuff out there. Yep. So, and we're going to talk about this now right after this. Joelle's going to do her first Facebook Live. So you guys want to get onto her Facebook page, which is Canines in Focus, I would imagine, right? Yeah. They can look that up and give us maybe, how about 9 o'clock? 9 o'clock p.m., Joelle will do a Facebook Live, and I believe I can share it. And if not, I'll make sure that I can share it. But you can also go to Canines in Focus. You'll be able to see it. So same format as usual. And Joelle, you start at the questions and just start reading your way down.
Okay. Jamal says, crazily, I was hoping she was on tonight. Thanks, Jamal.
See that?
Thanks.
Everybody's rooting for you.
So awesome.
Good.
Bentley says, yay, I made it into another one of these.
Awesome. And the reason why we're reading the questions, I know you guys can see it, but we've got a pretty big audience. We're on Spotify, iTunes, Google, SoundCloud. And they can't see it. So it goes into voice, the voice different platforms. So keep going.
Paul says, hello, folks. John Snow. Hey, Jeff, how long does it take for a person to become a dog trainer?
Great, John. John, you never stop. You never stop. You never stop. So I've been training dogs professionally for about 12 years right now. I've trained over 4,000 dogs. I've been saying that for 4,000 dogs for, I don't know, a few years now. So it's probably upwards or even towards more. My seminars alone, I'm training 1,000, 30 times 600 dogs a year just on that. You never stop. I mean, you can be training dogs for 30 years and suck. You can be training dogs for 2 years and be fantastic. So I think it's about, number one, how hungry are you? How open-minded are you to learn? What's your foundation and background? But even then, there's people that come from some of the best schools around and they can't train a dog for shit. So also depends on what kind of dog trainer you want to become. You know, do you want to do pet dogs? Do you want to do aggression rehab? Sport dogs. So, you know, but there's no reason, believe it or not, after 6 months of training in the streets, you can start helping clients. So everybody has value. Remember, your next door neighbor, you probably knows less about dogs than you do. And that's all that is important because you're trying to help them. I'm a family pet dog trainer. Next.
Jamal says, pushed her ass off the fence.
Damn right I did.
Always does. Lions roar.
So normally I would have made a sexist comment or a comment like, yeah, and a nice ass it is. But I can't say stuff like that because it's Joelle. So, but if it was my wife, I'd be able to say stuff like that. Or a non-employee, I'd say stuff like that. So maybe I'll say it anyway, just a disclaimer.
You already did.
Yeah, maybe I'll just say the stuff anyway. Guys, I'm always unprofessional on my shows. And just because it's Joelle, she doesn't get a free pass. No. All right? Right?
Right.
Can we agree on that?
Agreed.
All right.
All right.
There we go.
Lions roar. Hi. You had given me advice for training my service dog because he doesn't take treats. Your advice to use his food has helped so much. Thank you.
Awesome. So the big thing is any dog out there that is struggling with, oh, my dog doesn't, you know, take treats or isn't really food motivated, stop feeding your dog other than training. I'm not saying starve your dog. This isn't like SeaWorld or the zoo. What I'm saying is use the dog's daily food intake to motivate it. And some folks will say, well, he's sort of a picky eater. That's because you're probably overfeeding your dog. Next.
Susan Hanna says, looking forward to our Skype session on Monday.
Awesome, Susan. And Susan, it's much more professional than this, I assure you. Good.
Barbara, hello.
Hey, Barbara, how are you?
Jamal says, and she's killing
yes.
it. Thanks, Jamal.
Yes.
John Snow, what is a good way to get a dog to focus on you?
There's a couple different ways. Number one, you get a dog that's highly – okay, you're going to get dogs in. We get dogs in that are, like, highly motivated to work. And then we have a couple of dogs in right now that, like, don't care about anything. So you get a dog that's highly motivated to work, they're going to just work for you just for the work. Then you have dogs that are food motivated. They're going to work for you because you become a food machine. And then you can use some compulsion, which means leash corrections. And they're like, holy shit, I better pay attention to this handler because that person just become relevant in my life. So what do? You do a mixture of both. You do a mixture of both. But I don't need dogs to focus on me to like, ideally, sure, that would be great. I've seen all the videos. You see a lot of these high drive dogs that do that. But you get a lot of dogs that just don't care. Next.
Missy P, hey guys, I have a 5-month border collie. Recently, she started being shy and sometimes aggressive with strangers. Why is this and what can I do about it?
Missy P, probably age, probably going through another fear stage. Dogs up until a year old, they sort of go in and out of fear stages. Some of them are like, you know, exactly at this week. Other ones are just like, you know, whatever. It's probably the growth of the dog. What I would do right now is lots of confidence building. So what can you do for confidence building? General training, lots of structure. Get the dog out in public, but don't let people interact with the dog. That is the magic. Stop allowing people to put, I'm not saying you're doing this, Missy, but stop allowing people to put pressure on the dog. What do I mean by pressure? Walking up to it and petting it. That's actually pressure. That's a great way to get bit, by the way. But I'm a dog lover. Dogs love me. I got dogs that don't love you and will bite you for saying hello. Next. Not me personally. Not my personal dogs. Next.
Bentley S, how do you know which e-collar to choose from your website? And do you have a video on how to properly use them?
So Bentley, I've got thousands of videos on how to use them. I definitely have some specific ones. I have a video on how to take it out of the box, unpackage it, turn it on, turn it off, fit it to the dog, find the working level. The mini educator, the 300 series is a good video. It's a good one to start with. I would say 95, if not higher percent of the dogs we train use that one. And it's got nothing to do with the breed of the dog. You can use it on a Jack Russell, you can use it on a Labradoodle, and you can use it on a Pitbull and Rottweiler and German Shepherd. Next.
Jake McKinley, dog is skittish around children, really just wants to run from them. How do I get her to just be comfortable enough around to hold it down and stop trying to scoot away?
So what I would do is, Jake, so what I would do is number one is you got to advocate for the dog. So start advocating for the dog. What I mean by advocating is, number one, don't let kids walk up to the dog right now. Step one, neutralize the threat. The dog looks at kids in the threat. And by the way, FYI, some people are like, oh, it must have been abused by a kid. That's the biggest line of bullshit that is out there. No, it wasn't. That's got nothing to do with it. So some people are, oh, it must have been hit by a kid, the last owner, yada, yada, yada. No, nope. It probably hasn't been socialized with enough kids, or it thinks these tiny little critters that are running towards it are scary and nervous. Because wow, why? Because that's just how it is. So the best thing to do is get your dog to hold it down around children, create a little bubble around the dog. Maybe it's anywhere from 5 feet to 3 feet. It might be 2 feet. Get the dog to ignore the kids and exist with the kids. Next.
Ernie Simpson, Jeff, need some help, please. Off leash, my dog heals great. When I put him on leash, he wants to keep pressure and forage slightly ahead and is tight on the leash. How can I correct that?
Well, considering that Ernie, most of the walks you do are probably to be on leash, especially in city centers, there's a couple of different ways you can do that. Number one, you're going to have to use leash pressure. So it could be anything from just, you know, pop of the leash with some sort of training collar. Remember, it's got to be a quick pop. You can also use a remote collar. Remote collars are directional, though, so you need to actually guide the dog back where you want it. At some point, you're going to be on correction only. Dog forges ahead. You would use the remote collar on the nick or the momentary button, and it would be enough of a nick or of a feeling, call it a shock for all intents and purposes, that the dog goes, oh, so going out of heel sucks, and I'm supposed to go back into heel because I know how to go back into heel. Yes. So for all the folks out there that are new to my show, we're not just randomly picking a button. Also, if you're brand new to this show, you can hear me talk about a lot of punishment on this show. And I'm actually going to do a tip of the day on why I talk about punishment so much and why a bunch of dog trainers are refusing to talk about it because they want to appear to be like the nice dog trainers or the nice shock collar trainers. This isn't anybody in particular, but it's a little bit ridiculous how almost every dog trainer now, even my colleagues, are ignoring the fact that in order to stop an unwanted behavior, you have to use punishment. Anybody that says any different is lying to you. They're absolutely outright lying. Punishment is not a bad thing. It's a fact. It's just a fact. It's just how dogs learn, through reward and punishment. But if you want to get a dog to stop something, you can't reward them. Let's think about this logically. What I want everyone to do is I just want people to think about it logically. Now, some people might say, well, instead of punishment, Jeff, why don't you call it a correction? Okay. All right. I'll call it like eating dessert. Let's do this. Every time I say the word eating dessert, that means punishing the dog on a remote collar. Do you want me to say eating dessert? Like, does that make sense? No. Get off the freaking PC bullshit and let's talk about how dogs are actually really, really trained. And it's an actual thing you do. And you never yell at the dog. You don't scream at the dog. You're not upset or mad at the dog. It's just like, that was wrong. That's it. It's as simple as that. That was wrong. Remember taking a test and they put a little X on it? The answer is wrong. Like, we have to tell you that it's wrong. Like, you can't be mad at the instructor. It's 1 + 1 = 3. It's a wrong answer. So next.
Milligan Valley, how old do you like a puppy to be before using a pet convincer?
Again, a pet convincer is compressed air. It's like, looks like a little bit of a keyboard cleaner, outer with air. Well, depends on what the dog is doing. The dog's nipping at you right away. Dog's jumping right away. We don't punish dogs on obedience for a while till they know it. But if it's anything that's going to like lead to really unwanted behaviors, such as jumping or nipping, you can use it right away. Next.
Spinisper, registered for RV trainer in September. So freaking excited.
Oh, awesome. You're probably talking about the one in Providence. Yeah, cool. You'll be here for that one?
Yeah.
Nice.
I'll be
awesome.
Here.
Woo-hoo. Cool. You take pictures for me?
Of course.
Nice.
All right. Robin says, hello. When I give my dog a bone, she whines and tries to hide it. Seems she gets stressed. I want her to relax and enjoy it. What should I do? FYI, she does not have any resource guarding issues.
Well, Robin, if you're going to give me dessert, don't freaking tell me how to eat it, right? I'll eat it any way I want to eat it. That's probably not a worst example. I guess if I ate dessert in certain rooms of this house, she'd freaking punish me. So that's a bad example. The whining is probably, I don't know if it's quite stress. It could be excitement, hiding it. It could be, or it's also the precursor to hiding it because the dog wants to hide it. Bottom line is this, if it's a raw meaty bone, I wouldn't want my dogs hiding them because they're going to stink. So, but then again, I give my dogs bones outside. If it's like one of those bones you buy that's, you know, got artificial and fake stuff, you know, it's not going to go bad or spoil. So what do? Feed your dog a bone in a crate. How's that? Next.
Spinisper, Jeff, do you ever have your kids train dogs with you?
Not really anymore. I used to all the time. Back when the training center was at my home, my kids were, if you look at my Facebook page from 5 years ago, there's probably about 5 years of documented stuff with my kids training dogs every single day of their life because we're a homeschool family. Now they just go to the training center maybe once a week. And they don't really train the dogs, but they used to all train dogs. Next.
AJ, 11-month-old dog continues to whine when seeing other people's dogs on the walk after leash correction. What is the proper way to correct to stop this behavior?
Yeah, whining is a pain in the ass. It's also arousal and excitement. So the dog most likely is excited to do it. A lot of people are going to struggle with that. A lot of people are going to say, never punish a dog for whining because it's excited to see people because then it'll hate people. Guys, that's called imagined harm. It's a bunch of bullshit. What I would say is this, prove it. My answer is prove it. That's just, no, says who? Where's the study? No. And the reason why I say this stuff, because I hear a lot about that as well. I like to give both sides of the story. It's sort of like when I tell people, if a dog's whining in the crate, walk up to the dog's crate and hit it on the top. And people are like, never do that. The dog will have a negative association with the crate. Newsflash, guys, the dog already has a negative association in the crate before I showed up on the scene. It's got nothing to do with me. What'll happen is the dog will learn to shut up, and then the dog will be fine. So it's called imagined harm. You hear me talk about that a lot. It's supposed. We imagine that that could happen. Meanwhile, no one's ever done it before. Therefore, it's just an imaginary thing. So they heard about it from someone else. I would go switch to a remote collar. You can also bonk the dog. Whining is for bonking. Believe it or not, a bonker is a towel. It's a wrapped up towel. You can read about bonkers. We have them at our training center. Make sure you do a video with a bonker tomorrow or something. Maybe we'll do one. We'll do a Facebook Live with you about a bonker at the training center.
Really?
Yeah. We'll do it on my channel.
That's so the first.
So
okay.
We'll do it on my channel so you don't have to do it on yours if you feel bad. Okay? But yeah, we'll just show everybody what a bonker is and how it gets used. Next. Okay.
Chevy L, hi J and J. Can we say for now and forevermore, DA equals dog aggressive, so I can stop typing it out, LOL.
Sure, absolutely. And GSD still means German Shepherd Dog in my world. Yes.
Jason, hey Jeff, I've been watching all your videos and trainings, been going great. What's the best way to teach a game of fetch? My 8-month GSD just wants to play chase.
Okay, so this is the thing. I don't teach fetch. I have high ball drive dogs. Yeah. So I was fortunate that they just like, oh, we'll just chase that thing and bring it back and you'll throw it again. I teach them how to release the ball and I teach them how to recall. But even recall is easy because I'm the guy throwing the ball. So it just becomes common sense for the dog. There is something called forced fetch. I don't teach that. A lot of people do. A lot of pet dog trainers don't. That is in the sports dog world. That's in the competition world. That's definitely in the hunt world, in a trick training world. So forced fetch. Find some videos on that. Next.
Lions Roar. Plan on asking to enter a mentorship under a service dog trainer at a program that have a really low washout rate. Any advice for anyone planning on taking classes and pushing to become dog trainers?
No, not at all. Other than don't get, you know, every place is different. And don't get sucked in this. Depends. If they say never, if they have a low washout rate, that's probably not because necessarily always the training. That's because of how they pick the dogs. It could be a combination of both, but it's probably because how they pick the dogs. It's hard. Most dogs cannot be service dogs. And even once, there's dogs that go through an 18-month program. Look, 18 months of training, dog, and it washes out for something that happened, like something just popped up, and they don't know how to fix it. That's the real problem. Is like we can fix that real quick, but they're like, no. You can correct service dogs, guys. In fact, I wouldn't want my kid or myself to have a service dog that didn't know what the word no was. And I'll give you a great example. So, but you can always learn that afterwards. So you can take the course, become a mentee, learn everything, and then you can always forward your forward, maybe wrong word, get more training.
Yeah.
Forward your learning.
Yeah.
Forward your learning. Would that be the right phrase? Forward your learning.
I think so.
You can get more learning done. But here's a great example. I'm in a wheelchair and I need a dog to pick stuff up. I trained my dog to go to my refrigerator, open the door, take out a bottle of water and bring it back to me. Very common thing for a dog to do. Also, I left my phone on the counter and I need my dog to bring it to me. Very common things for service dogs to do for people that have mobility issues. What happens if I'm sitting there watching TV and out of the blue, my dog goes to the refrigerator and opens up the refrigerator, takes out a water bottle and brings it back to me. And I didn't ask for it and does it every 15 minutes. And next thing I know, I've got 5 water bottles in front of me. very real potential scenario. What do? You need to punish. You can't reward. You can't reteach. The dog already knows it. Like, the dog already knows how to do the task. So be careful about some service dog companies. They don't use punishment. Some do. I'd want to learn how to stop an unwanted behavior in a service dog, considering that it's life and death for a lot of people. Next.
Obligamer. Hey, Jeff, I'm going to get my first dog. What age and breed should I get?
If it's your very first dog, don't get a puppy. Look for a one-year-old dog that has no human aggression, no dog aggression, and is not afraid of stuff. All right? Don't get the dog in the shelter that's cowering in the back because you feel bad. Nothing against anybody that does that. For your first dog, for your fifth dog, that's going to be hard. And don't get a puppy. Why? They're very difficult to raise. I know they're cute, but they're cute for 5 minutes, and then they have to go out every 2 hours, and then they don't know anything for a long time. So I would get a one-year-old plus dog. Breed, we can go by, how about size? Let's go by size and activity level, right? So what's your lifestyle? And be practical with your lifestyle. Oh, yeah, I'm going to take it hiking 3 times a week. Buddy, you don't hike at all. You know what I mean? It's like, yeah, I'm going to take it out on a canoe. You hate the water, you know? So be practical. And then find one that's pretty balanced, you know? Pulling on the leash, 3 minutes. Jumping, 30 seconds. All that stuff's easy to fix. Next.
Snowfoot 21. My dog has recently started scratching at his e-collar when I press the stim button. Should I correct for this or not?
Yes, you can. Next.
Scroll down too far. Natalie Shepard. If I have 2 dogs, can I bring one to each day of a seminar or ask about how to address the one I have?
Okay.
I leave home?
So Natalie, I wouldn't. I actually would not bring just, I would bring the same dog both days because the dogs are going to evolve from day one to day two. So it's you're better off bringing one dog. Bring your most difficult dog. Bring your most difficult dog. So, and bring a dog that struggles with like other dogs, if that's one of the issues, because there'll be a lot of other dogs there. Or find someone else to get a ticket for a working spot and then bring both. Next.
I actually asked you that same question when I came here.
Yeah.
Chevy, I overcorrected my DAGSD with e-collar, so we are back to basics for a few weeks. Conditioning heel in place and not doing any corrections. Is this how you would go? Get solid before tackling corrections?
Depends what you corrected them for. If you corrected your dog for what? Growling? There's really no overcorrection. I mean, sorry. Or by trying to bite you? No. But I don't know what the overcorrection was for. Was it for obedience or was it for a behavior that you're trying to extinguish? Because if it's for a behavior you're trying to extinguish, you really can't overcorrect. And some people say, well, sure you can. No, because if the dog stopped the behavior, it worked. And if it doesn't stop the behavior, believe it or not, you undercorrected even though you think you overcorrected. So if it's for obedience and you freak the dog out, yeah, take a couple steps back. Next.
Leo, what do you use for dogs that are raw fed? When training, I see your trainers using kibble.
They use their dog's daily food. Sometimes we can use dried liver. They make dehydrated food that you can do. A lot of dogs, though, that eat raw and have to come to us at least, we tell the owners to put them on kibble. Because it's like a lot of the dogs that come to us, it's life or death. So for 3 weeks of its life, 5 weeks of its life, it's gonna go back to kibble. I think that's really, really important because it's like, who cares about the dog's diet right now? We're trying to keep you alive. So we deal with different types of dogs. Like we've got dogs right now. There's a dog in there right now that like is just really struggling. And then I see dogs that like are doing great in our facility. And then I see my colleagues who are working some of these other dogs that are like high drive, which are like, they're fine. So we get dogs that are struggling mentally with huge amounts of issues. And a lot of times you don't get drive out of these dogs at all. You literally don't get drive. So you can switch it up. Just go to kibble. Next.
Keith, can I somewhere stop by 7-month lab, destroy all her toys? Why is she doing that? Is that a behavior? Should I be worried about? Thanks, Jeff.
Keith, remember when you were 13, 14, 15 years old? why did you play with yourself so much? Right? Come on. Like, and if you didn't, like, what were you doing? Like, right? What were you doing? Like, hello? So this is the thing, Keith. Why does a dog do it? It does it because they can. Now, you do have dogs out there that get toys, these little tiny toys for 99 cents that, like, yeah, he's had it for 2 years. But then you also get, it's rare, not in my world. So this is the thing. All these toys that your dog is destroying, stop buying them. Literally, you're wasting your money. It's a waste of money. Dogs don't need them. Just give them a freaking box of Kleenex. Let them destroy that. Please don't do that. But I'm just saying. So what I do is my dogs don't have toys. Now, we play Chuck It. That's a toy. We have pool toys, and they chew bones. That's it. I'm not against playing fetch. I'm not against a toy. But giving a dog some 99 cents, and that's just a price. But you know what I'm talking about. All these toys that you buy that are marketed towards dog owners to suck us in to use this emotional thing that we love our dogs, so we'll buy them more stuff. We'll buy them more stuff. And yeah, if I was an inventor of BarkBox, maybe I'd be like, your dog needs more toys. But it's like, whatever. No, don't worry about it. Next.
Lisa Armstrong, GSV 7 months old, working on prong collar training. Going great. Thank you. Regarding hiking on single trail, since we just started walking on prong collar, would this be confusing to a pup? Should I wait?
No, not at all. I would still bring a leash with you. Still bring a leash with you and just do it. And single trails in New England, our trails are narrow. So I was a hardcore backpacker with my dogs many, many years ago. And then I would also backpack over in Europe in the Swiss Alps. Trails are different. And when I backpacked out west in California or Oregon or Nevada, the trails are even different there. But in New England trails where they're really, really narrow, you can't heel your dog. So my dogs were either – I choose be in front of me or behind me. But they had incredible recall. And I would suggest getting your dog to be remote power trained. If you're going to have your dog off leash. If you're not going to have your dog off leash, then just let it walk a little bit in front of you or behind you. You decide. Just don't call it heel or whatever your word is for walking next to you. Next.
Jeff Bennett, have a dog that used to be human and dog aggressive. Using your videos, he's now good with people, but I'm having trouble with dogs. He was attacked by an off-leash dog about a year ago.
Yeah, that'll F up the dog. That's why everyone, you know, all the times that dogs come running up to us, I'm like, you kick them and you kick them hard. So let's get your dog to be comfortable around other dogs. It's not your fault. Let's make sure that no dog approaches your dog, even on a leash, even one that is supposedly friendly. Dog can never meet dogs on leashes. When I say never, geez, Jeff, my dog can never meet dogs on leashes. My dogs never do. Well, it's not that hard. So just don't do it. Just don't do it. It probably feels that it's got to attack because it's going to get attacked. That's how I got into dog training. By the way, so my dog was attacked at a very young age, right across the street from me by two dogs. And from that day on, it was massively reactive and aggressive towards other dogs. That was the turning point in my dog's life. That's why I'm so freaking extreme when I say, hey, when an off-leash dog comes up to you, you kick it and you kick it hard. And if the owner's 10 feet away, but that dog's off-leash, I don't give a shit. Call your dog back, or I will make sure it doesn't come up to me. We have an obligation to do that. Why? It can cost you thousands of hours, thousands of dollars to fix that problem. And why do I have to be stuck with that bill when you're the irresponsible dog owner? So what I would do is get your dog to start existing around balanced dogs. You got to find balanced dogs for it to be around, and then you start integrating it in a social environment. If it was at our training center, which you're not, what we would do is we'd have that around a lot of dogs, and we would advocate for the dog. So look for someone that does a structured socialization around you, another person that does balance training. Next.
Larissa, how do you train the balance?
Hold on. Congratulations on that rehabbing of the human aggression, though. That's a freaking accomplishment. Next.
Larissa, how do you train the balance between an alert bark and not making the dog think it needs to protect? I've been letting my dog bark at strangers, at windows and door, but now I know I should not.
You tell it to shut up. No, okay, I don't know what your feeling about guns are. I'm pro-choice on a lot of things. So if you choose to have a handgun or any other weapon, I'm like, go for it. You know, so I'm, you know, I choose to have a handgun. And I will protect my family. I am old school. I'm not a violent person, but I have no problem protecting my children and my family, my staff. My staff knows I'm very protective over them. It's not a control freak thing either, by the way. It's like, I freaking care about you. But then again, I'll protect the general public as well. So chances are, if you've got a dog and one bark is not so bad, but you don't need your dog barking in windows. You know that now. You've come to realize it. That's why I asked the question. So just remote collar. Hey, knock it off. That's enough. I don't need to hear that anymore. Next.
Kiki, do you normally do 3-month internships like Joelle is doing?
Yeah, we are. We have our next one lined up as well. It's a very, I don't want to say it's a difficult program to get into, but it's select. Joelle, number one, I knew her before this. She came to one of my seminars and we had different correspondence. There has to be a huge thing. She's living on the property. So it has to be it's a combination of personality as well. And not with me. I mean, she doesn't have to get along with me. I mean, I guess I'm being, you sort of, I mean, you got to at least get along with me, but you have to be a good mix for the staff. She's working with all my staff. So it has to be a good blend for the staff. So there's that. You have to know basic dog handling technique because that becomes a safety issue. So you can't just come in green, totally green. And if you come with an attitude that like, I love dogs, that's not a plus. That's like, no. I want to help a lot of people. Ah, now you're speaking my language. And we have our next one already lined up. She's coming in October, November, and December. When are you moving out again? When are you going to be out of that room? When are you going to be out of that room?
Not soon enough.
She's chomping at the bit.
September, right?
She's coming up from South Carolina. She's like, when can I get there, Jeff? No, she's not, actually. No, she is, but she's not chomping at the bit. Yeah, don't worry about it. You can stay as long as you want. Okay. I'd hire you, but that wouldn't work.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I don't want you to. I want you to have your own thing. That's the goal. So that's it. Next.
Natalie Shepherd. One dog.
Really? Natalie Shepherd, are you from Toronto, Natalie? Did you work on that C-16 bill? Is that this? Seriously, is that Natalie Shepherd? I'm honored to have you on my show. Next.
One dog is leash reactive and jumps. The other has history of killing a cat, guarding, and possibly biting, planning to bring a second dog.
Okay.
That's regarding your seminar.
Okay, so leash reactive and jumping is easy to fix. Okay, now. The cat stuff we can fix real quick. Guarding, possibly biting. That's a tough one. That's a tough one. Jumping is easy. You'll fix that in 2 seconds. Think about it really hard. Both of those dogs would be good candidates. Getting a dog to not kill a cat, that's easy. Remote collar. Possibly biting. I can help you identify the trigger warnings on that one. Leash reactive, though, that you need a lot of role play, though. That might be helpful for you. If you're already using a prong collar, already using a remote collar, and you're still struggling with leash reactivity, that might be a good dog to bring. If you're using no tools whatsoever, get yourself a prong collar, start with that, and at least start walking the dog on a prong collar. All right? Next.
Kiki, when do you know to correct a growl? Have a dog that will give a short warning when a dog cat sometimes walks by bed or crate, but it's very random.
I don't correct all growling. If I had one of my dogs lying down on the ground, like they are right now, and another dog walked up to it, and the dog lying down growled at it, as long as that other dog moved away, I wouldn't care. I wouldn't care. Next.
Lisa Armstrong says, thank you.
You're welcome.
Chevy says, was for DA reactivity. She was reacting and then acting as if I corrected her, screaming anxiety before I even pressed the button.
You might have pressed the button without knowing it. Don't worry about it. I would keep your plan up. Sometimes you just have sensitive dogs. Sometimes you have sensitive dogs. I wouldn't worry about it. Next.
Hungry Animal Foundation. Hey, Jeff, how's it going?
Oh, hey, what's up? Things are great. Things are awesome.
Susan, I just adopted a greyhound and she was freaking out in the crate.
I know.
Use the e-collar once and no more scratching and trying to get out.
I know.
You'd
think a greyhound would freaking not freak out in a crate. Like that's all greyhounds do is go into crates, go into kennels. So Good for you. I'm glad you fixed it. Yep. And the dog doesn't have a negative association with the crate now, does it? No, it doesn't. There you go. Next.
Lisa Armstrong, do you have a video on how to keep my 7-month-old GSP from bugging my older, smaller dog?
No, there's no video on that. There's no video on that because that's not a video. That's sort of like, no, I don't have a video on that. You could just ask the question. What you would do is tell your 7-month-old dog to mind its own business, put some more structure in your dog's life. And what you do is you can have a remote collar on your dog. And when it's bugging it, which probably means it's trying to engage it in play, tell it to knock it off. Tell it to knock it off, right? So great example. Angelo, he's 5. He's got sisters that are 13 and 11. He keeps going to the room to bug them. And I'm being serious. How do I stop it? I walk over to Angelo and I'm like, Angelo, leave your freaking sisters alone. Cut it out, buddy. Now, he's a human. He understands that. He's 5, right? He'll go crying, be like, oh, my God. Da, 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 da. He'll go running off and he'll sulk. And then guess what? He'll start playing a game or reading a book or playing with a toy and he'll be fine. With your German Shorthair pointer, what I want you to do is number one, your dog should be, if your dog's not on voice command, it should be on a leash in the house. So not too many 7-month-old dogs are fully off-leash trained under voice control. So number one, I would spend a lot of that time in the house doing duration work, being in place. Now, you're not training something new. I don't believe in training an alternative behavior to fix a bad behavior. I don't believe in doing that. I just believe in training dogs. So have your dog being lying down on a dog bed and then have structured playtime. But during the structured playtime, if your dog's being too rough, and it just might be like just too energetic for your other dog, you just have to tell that dog to knock it off. So knock it off. Next.
Hillary. Hi, Joelle. Looking good. Hey, Hillary. Thanks. I planned my shirt to match Jeff tonight.
She had no idea she was doing this. Next.
Hungry Animal Foundation. Haven't been watching your videos for a while. My mother just recently passed away, and if it wasn't for my dog, Mystery, I would have lost it a long time ago. Animals help with the grieving process.
Awesome. Awesome. And I'm glad you had a balanced dog that a lot of dogs can become worse if you put too much emotional baggage on them. Number one, I'm sorry that your mother died. It really, really sucks. Glad that you have, a dog or, anyone else there to help you. And I'm glad that your dog is making it through it as well. Next.
Gary, your videos have made a huge difference and my family is now watching the videos. So we are all on the same page. Thank you.
All right, Gary. Love you, buddy. Next.
He says, thank you, Buffalo, New York.
All right. Hey, I love Buffalo. I used to spend I was at the last night, the Playboy Club was open in Buffalo, New York. I think it was the last night. And I think it was the Playboy Club. There used to be a club a long time ago. There was that. And there was another club that was there that was the inside of an airplane. Or maybe it was a restaurant that was the inside of an airplane. This goes back a long time. Maybe 30 years ago. Next.
Jeff Bennett. Thanks, Jeff. How about coming to Key West in January, February for a seminar in order to thaw out?
Jeff, if I can get 35 people to show up, I'll be there. You've got to find me a location to host it at. Actually, I've got a fan there.
Nice.
Yeah, she goes to my seminars. Yeah.
Key West.
Yeah, Key West. She lives there. She bartends at one of the outdoor clubs out there. They're all female bartenders and they got frozen drinks. It's like, yeah, that's Key West. I don't know the name of it. She dog trains during the day, bartends at night. If you can find me a location that I can fit 35 people, I'll be there. Next.
Gary says, also, since our dog is now doing so well, we plan to add another.
Nice. Smart.
Yep.
Smart.
Hungry Animal Foundation. I've got a lot of catching up
to
do.
Yeah, you do. Don't worry about it. I'm spewing the same bullshit I have been for years. Next.
Robin says, if a dog is unsure about something on a walk and low growls, would you correct that? Low growl and backing away?
Okay. If the dog's off leash and it's concerned about something, I'd have to play it by ear. First of all, is this, am I concerned about it? Okay. Am I concerned about it? So say it's a kid in a stroller. No, 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 no. No growling. But I wouldn't allow an off-leash dog to approach a kid in a stroller. So it would be on a leash. What I would do is if I'm walking a dog on a leash and it growls at any environmental, I'm going to correct. Next.
Chevy says, thanks heaps, Jeff.
You're welcome.
Montreal Canine Training.
Hey, Montreal. What's going on? Bonjour. Excuse my American accent.
It's great. For clients who feed their dog raw food, as you know, meat patties can get quite messy. So for board and train, what type of food do you recommend to switch to? Maybe a specific brand and type?
We actually allow our boarding clients to do raw. We have a huge stand-up freezer. If you check out, you see all that raw I got today?
Yeah.
Do you like that?
Mm-hmm.
See that
I'm
photo?
I'm going to go to that market.
Well, yeah. I'll tell you. When do you want to go?
Whenever.
Sundays are only open until 3.
I mean, I have enough for this week for West.
Do you? All right. Well, maybe when you come back from New Hampshire, okay. We'll go. They're open until 7 o'clock at night. Okay? I mean, you can go on your own, obviously. But, yeah, I'm going to probably need more. Anyway, I'm going to start stocking up. I'm probably going to buy a new freezer this week, too, for the house.
Sweet.
Yeah. So you can get patties. You can just freeze them. Get a special freezer for your clients if you want to. We carry – what do we have back there? What are those huge bags of kibble that we serve? From?
Yeah.
I think we do from. From is sort of like our stock dry kibble, from chicken, grain-free. Next.
Lisa says, thanks again.
You're welcome.
Larissa, thanks. You are right. A gun would give us both confidence and protection. Getting an e-collar first, gun second.
Yeah. And if you never fired a handgun, definitely go to a hand. And if I'm offending anybody, I apologize. I mean, I'm just like, believe it or not, we might have the same views on a lot of things, so don't chop my head off. But I find is, that's why I like long format interviews with people. I just posted something about Jordan Peterson today. There's a lot of people out there that don't like Jordan Peterson because they're not watching his interviews. They're watching a soundbite from an interviewer that put him on the spot, but turning it into something. He does great long format interviews though with Joe Rogan. He does a bunch. His own lectures are really great. But anyway, I like long format. The point being is definitely want to practice shooting that gun. And believe it or not, it's funny, especially with females, because Linda went and shot a gun when we were in Texas. I probably got so much positive feedback, and my audience skews female. It's about 80% female. I had people come out of the woodwork, like praising her for learning how to shoot a gun. You'd be surprised how many people out there, especially females, are advocating for personal safety. Next.
Mm-hmm. Lisa says, particular brand of e-collar?
We use the Mini Educator from e-collar technology. As I like to say to people, it's the one I'm holding in 5,000 of my videos, like every single time. It's the one that's on my website. So yeah, e-collar technology, you can buy them right off of us, but you don't have to. I don't do this show to make money. Speaking of which, there is a little dollar sign at the bottom of your chat box that you can click on. And if you do, you actually can get your question popped right up to the top and you can ask a super, you can become a super fan. And like Linda and I can't do this with Joelle because I don't take her out on dates. We've been out to dinner though a bunch of times. We're not dates though.
You bought me quail eggs today for my dog.
Does that mean that I care?
Yeah.
Right.
It was really nice. Thanks, Jeff.
Hey, Paul, if you're listening to this, Paul's her husband. Paul, if you're listening to this and you really want to like impress her, quail eggs.
It was a nice gesture.
Quail eggs. Yeah. So, I forgot what we were talking about. I don't know how we got. Date night money. That's what it was.
Yeah.
Just thinking about
it. Linda needs to get out of the house.
Yeah.
Anyway. Stuck with this guy all day.
I know. There you go.
Next. All right. Melissa Stripmatter. Yep. Taught my miniature schnauzer how to swim today.
Nice.
Thanks for the free info.
All right, Melissa. Next.
Jamal also said, yeah, great pick on the raw. How long is that going to last you?
I know you think you love your dog by cooking all its food, but feed a damn. The dog wants some damn raw food, you know, and if it had a choice, it would kill it, just to let you know. But that's going to be like, that's part of my 20%. So I do 80% like beef or chicken, and then 20% I put in a combination of, just if you go to my Instagram page, you'll see what I bought today. Bull testicles is in the mix. So I'm excited about that. I got to chop those up too. That should be interesting to see what happens if they... Are they going to explode? Are they going to... What's going to happen
to
those?
Might.
I don't know. That's a hell of a meme.
You should really film it.
I will.
Busy.
I'll Angela doing it.
Perfect.
Papa, what are those?
I think with those, you should have them semi-frozen.
Yeah, absolutely.
For that reason.
Yeah. I got a feeling they're going to slice.
Yeah.
Nice. Like almost like liver.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. Next.
Busy Panda. What if my dog doesn't go to the bathroom enough?
Give it more water, I guess. I don't know. That's a vet question. But what's enough, though? Like, what is enough? So if you're worried about your dogs, that's not a dog training question. That's a health question, which I don't have the skill set or the knowledge to answer. But it's possible that it's dehydrated. Next.
Robin, Doberman is going to be 1 year old in a few weeks. Happy to be slowly getting into adulthood.
Nice, Robin. Ah, what happened?
I got it. Montreal canine training. During a mid-board and train, when clients come in to work with their dogs, some dogs get super excited, might even jump up on them. How do you address the situation? Punisher or let it go?
So Montreal canine training. I punish it. Why? I want the owner to see how it's done. I don't want pickups in mid-trainings to be perfect. And mid-trainings are rarely even close to perfect. I want every owner to see how to stop an unwanted behavior, or else the dog goes home and it does something and you're not prepared. The owner's not prepared to fix it. So you punish it. You'd be good. You'd be a good candidate for my Patreon page. If you join my Patreon page, I'll type it in. Patreon.com/solidk9. Canine training. Boom. If you'll see that, if you join that, that showed up in the last comment, I think. I don't know where my stuff shows up. You can do monthly Skypes, but I want the owner to see how I fix that next. And by the way, they're probably going to do it.
Spinisper, where do we even get quail eggs in New Hampshire? I'm getting some when I come down to Rhode Island for the seminar. What is the name of the market?
The name of the market is Armando's. And if you're coming out for the weekend seminar, that would be on a Saturday. They're open until 7 p.m. And on a Sunday, they're not going to be open. They're only going to be open during the seminar. So next, it's called Armando's. But you can probably get quail eggs in New Hampshire.
Probably. Right? I haven't looked, but I'm sure there must be.
Yeah, farms. We have tons of Spanish markets. Not that it's a Spanish market thing, but we have tons of Spanish markets in Rhode Island. Rhode Island is like, Providence is almost half Hispanic, I think. Yeah, next.
Cecily M., fearful dog refuses to walk down the street. Please describe how often I can guide him down the street each day, short sessions or every other day, short sessions.
You can, first of all, what equipment are you using? So you want to make sure your dog's at least on a prong collar and a leash. And if you think prong collars are bad for fearful dogs, it's actually the best thing for a fearful dog. And remote collars, shock collars are even better for fearful dogs. She's on a prong. Okay, good. So you're on a prong. So don't guide the dog. Lead the dog. Lead the dog. So practice walking in your backyard or up and down your driveway or on a place with not a lot of environmentals. Master, when I say master, that doesn't mean like it has to be perfect. The walk, then go down the street and lead the dog. Let's go. We're walking. That's what we would do. And we're not going to drag you down the street. You're going to walk down the street, but we're going to lead you down the street. Next.
She said, thank you in advance. Love you guys. You all rock the Casbah.
Wow.
Kindle, would you come to Northern Cali for a seminar? What time of year would you like?
Sure. Guys, I'm hired help. Okay. First, for full clarification, I'll be in Seattle in 2 weeks. That's sold out, though. I'm trying to open up seats, but it's been, I don't know if I'll be able to. I'm going to be in Seattle. I'm hired help. That's how I make a living. I literally, like all this stuff is free that I do. Like most people know me from my free stuff. I actually make a living doing seminars. Like that's how I get paid. I mean, I've got a big family, a lot of expenses. I need to make a living. So that's actually how I make my money is through my seminar business. And then I also make my money through private Skypes.
I learned everything for free by watching many vids and reading in between the lines, but this is on-the-spot advice. It's priceless.
Montreal, thanks. I did some stuff up at a rescue in Montreal. I did a seminar for a rescue in Montreal. You guys are still doing that silly BSL thing, I think, aren't they? They try to ban tools there, too? Mm-hmm. What the hell are they thinking? Next.
Lisa Armstrong, will the pups eventually make it off the prong collar? I see some adult dogs with them, and their owners say they've had them on for years.
Yeah, that's not a failure. I wear my seatbelt every day. Guys, like, wearing a prong collar does not mean your dog is a bad dog. It doesn't mean your dad's a bad dog at all. And wearing a remote collar off leash for when? Hopefully forever. It's not just for puppies at all. If anything, if you are fortunate to get a puppy at 8 weeks old, you may never need a prong collar. You may never need like a lot of stuff because you're fortunate that you could shape that behavior. But having a prong collar on your dog is not a sign of failure. So that's actually smart dog ownership, in my opinion. So our goal is not to get a dog off of a prong collar. That is not our goal. We have one and only one primary goal, at least me, and that's to make dog owners' lives better. Dog owners' lives better. I've said it many times, and I'm proud of it. Everybody thinks I'm like, I love dogs. Sure, dogs are nice. I care about them. I love human beings. I love the human race. I love your neighbor. I love people. And if I can do something that makes their world and life better for them, sign me up. So, and by the way, I'm not mad. I'm just intense. When I'm training a dog, I actually don't talk at all. Joelle's probably going, you should train more dogs, Jeff. So we don't have to freaking listen to you talk so much. It's like, I know, both her and my wife. I was lost my train of thought again. I'm just thinking about like, you know, prong collars. Don't be in any rush to get off of it. I'm not mad at you. Sometimes I come across that way. Next.
It's very passionate.
It's like, God, jumped down my throat. I asked him a simple question and he jumped down my throat. It's like, no. I'm not mad. You've never seen me mad at me.
No.
Milligan
Valley. If you like this Montreal, you'll love Patreon.
Yep. It's true.
Cecily, how do you play with a fearful dog? Already training, charging the mark, touch, focus, but need the dog to play with a tug or ball.
Okay, so Joe, so train tug. You can take a fearful dog and teach him tug. So tug. I don't train tug, but all my dogs play tug. I train them how to release the tug. I train them how to do that. I shouldn't say that. I trained Girl anti-tug. Listen to this story. Girl, who's one of my shepherds, I trained her, if I have something in my hand, you never touch it. And if something's in your mouth and I reach for it, without any words, you let go and back away. This is how I trained Girl. And I did it so my kids would always be safe. So and my kids are really good around dogs. My kids would never just walk up to a dog and just grab something out of their mouth. They're not stupid. And if my kids, there'd be consequence to my kids if they did that. And no, I wouldn't put a shock collar on them. All right. So what I did was imagine trying to train tug to a dog that was trained to never touch something that I had. Meanwhile, I want you to tug this thing. So the first session I had with Girl training tug, I had a tug toy. I got her excited about it. She put it in her mouth. Her eyes saw my hand. She freaking let go and almost, like, she didn't quite run away, but she backed away. That's how much anti-tug she knew. And it took me about 4 to 5 days to teach her a really good tug game. And so now that's not my skill set, is to teach people how to play tug. There's really good videos out there from a lot of folks on how to teach tug. So I would watch those videos. Next.
Cecily said, unfortunately, when I pull the tug around on a string, he looks at it and is reluctant to chase.
Yeah, I don't know. That's not my skill set. You might have a low drive dog. Next.
Spinisper, my dog is 11 and we are getting a prong for the first time just to tweak some training inconsistencies.
It looks like, I think you might have missed a question. Hungry Animal.
Oh, I did. I'm sorry. Okay. Hungry Animal Foundation would love to have you visit us in Kingsport, Tennessee.
Yeah, I mean, I'll be in Knoxville. I'll be in Knoxville, Tennessee. I'm going to be in Frederick, Maryland, and then I'm going to be in Greenville, South Carolina. Greenville, South Carolina is very drivable. I'll be in Knoxville, Tennessee in between just to visit my daughter. Next. And I'll have no free time. Next.
This is Spin a Sperm. My dog is 11, and we are getting a prong for the first time just to tweak some training and consistencies.
Awesome. Cool.
Chevy just started contributing a little to Patreon. Thank you so much for putting all your knowledge out there. I'll go to Skype level when I sell my house in a couple months.
Yeah, I mean, Chevy, like, if you just don't, like, the lowest you can do is $5 a month. Like, I love you just as much for that as I do for $100 a month. And I've got people who do $100 a month because they need that Skype every month. They need that. And it's worth it for them because their lives are, you know, dramatically changing. But to me, the act of caring is huge. It's like, you know, all those people on the side of the road that have the sign that want money? I always have probably about, I don't know, $30 in singles and a couple of fives, and I keep it up. If anybody wants to break into my car, go ahead. You'll get like $35. I keep it in like where you're supposed to keep your eyeglasses. And every time that I can stop so I don't have to hold up traffic, I always give somebody a dollar. Always. Now, you could easily say, well, you know, they're lazy bums and they're probably buying drugs or alcohol. And I'm like, okay, that's fine. I gave. I showed love. Now, would I give them a check for $1,000? No. Will I pay someone else's rent for $500 a month? Yeah. I'll do that. So the act of giving, though, we're all on our own journey. But give, share, care, love. Just, you know, think about it. Next.
Lisa says, LOL, just passionate. Thank you.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah, very. Robin, any breed you'd never consider getting besides a male?
I'd get a male. I would get a male when I'm like older and don't have as much shit to do. You know what I mean? I would. I mean, I thought about breeding Kira. And people are like, why do you want to breed your dog? There's enough dogs out there. There's not enough good temperament, health, you know, Czech Republic dogs like Kira having litters. I'll tell you that much. You know, and I know where, and they'd all be gone. They wouldn't go to any pet families at all. They'd all go into a working dog program with a buddy of mine. If they have the right temperament, the rest of them would probably go to some select family, but they wouldn't probably go to family dogs because most family people unfortunately can't do it. So, I like a bigger dog. I like to, my wife's got Chihuahuas. They're no fun to take swimming. Sorry. They're no fun to take in the swimming pool. They know how to swim. I can't take them they can't swim in the ocean. They're not conducive to my lifestyle. But I'd get a lot of different. I mean, I would get a Jack Russell. So I would get that. I like a higher energy, active dog. Next.
Spongetacular. My dogs like to poop on my guitars.
Keep your guitars off the floor. Next.
Melissa, can you guys make a video with the Yorkie you guys have at the training center? Being the owner of three little ones might teach some people small dogs can be trained too.
Okay, so this is what I want you to do. First of all, that Yorkie is probably not the best video. Okay, that Yorkie is probably not the best dog to make a video of because that Yorkie does not like to work. That Yorkie does not like to work. But we've trained many small dogs. Now, who to really follow is Hillary. Hillary's company is Wellesley.
Wellesley Pet.
Hillary, put your name of your – what's the name of your company, hon?
Yeah, put it in there.
We'll give Hillary – Hillary owns three small dogs, and she rocks the training. She rocks the training. So, yep, next. But so that dog right there is – that dog is struggling – with motivation right now. So it will not make a good video at all. It won't make a good video. So the dog came to us neurotic in the crate. It's broken out of almost every crate. It poops and pees all the time in the crate and it bites. Those three things we've eliminated. I think it's been dry every morning. Has it been dry every morning still?
Yeah,
still.
It licked my hand.
But it's in the morning. You go in there.
Yeah, no issues.
No issues. Holy shit. so that dog is not pissing and shitting in crates anymore, which in my book is freaking the probably better than the, that's worth the cost of admission right there. She had to bathe that dog every single day she was bathing that dog, as well as cleaning out the crate. So, and then biting, it's not biting us anymore. And also all the neurotic behavior in the crate, that has been eliminated. I think it's been with us for what, a week? It's been a week, but it's obedience. It isn't motivated to work. So that's not the best dog. Next.
Jamal, addressing negativity on my social media, simply erase and block every single time or use it as a chance to inform the public. I'm struggling with how to deal with them.
So Jamal, explain, you could be helping people. Listen, I would block and delete it. And then if you want to use that as a motivation for another video, go ahead. But don't ever respond to people. Don't ever respond to the negativity. You know, don't ever respond to the negativity. So, you know, I would. You block. You first you block the person, and then you delete the comment. And if it's anything threatening, you can report them. You can report them. So if anybody's using the N-word with you at all, you could be like, hate speech, boom. If anybody is, you know, I mean, like with me, when I was going over to Europe, I got death threats and I was called, I got called a greedy Jew. And we screenshotted a lot of stuff over there because we were getting death threats about doing a seminar over there. And we actually reported it to the police, and actually the police took action. So they don't like that. The internet law over in Scotland of 2012 or the UK, it protects you from hate speech. And they were having a bunch of suicide. A lot of kids were committing suicide because of being online bullied. So it's sort of like an online bully thing. But that's a whole different topic. But if you're getting anything hateful, report it to that platform because those people can be removed and they should be removed. They should be removed from social media. It's not a freedom of speech issue. Sorry. So next.
Bushcraft Scott, my GSD would eat a chihuahua for a snack.
That's not good. I got GSDs and chihuahuas. Next.
Jamal, he clarified. It's good pup Wesley.
Wellesley. Wellesley's a city up in Mass. Yeah.
Melissa says, gotcha. Thanks, guys. And Cecily, anxious dog barks and whines when tethered. He is not trained with a remote collar, working level. And the owner doesn't plan on using a collar. Is it unethical to put a dog to bark collar on him?
Okay. First of all, why is the dog tethered? Is the dog on your property? If the dog's okay, is this a client dog? Okay. First of all, is the dog on your? Are you talking about a neighbor's dog?
I said yes. It's boarding.
It's boarding? Oh, if it's boarding, it should be following all your rules, and the owner should know about that beforehand. Yes, it's unethical if the owner doesn't know about it. In my opinion. Absolutely. I'm sorry. You know, in my opinion, it is unethical. So all of our dogs, all the owners know what we do and they're on board with it. So I would make it a new policy of yours that these are the tools that I use. And if your dog is whining or barking in a crate, then it's going to have a bark collar on it. And if you don't like it, then I'm not going to board your dog. Take your dog somewhere else, and you don't have that as a client. But I would want to know why is it? I'm not sure why the dog is tethered though. What's it tethered to? Why don't you just crate it? Next, you had no idea the dog would behave that way. Who said it?
Cecily.
It's a dog. Of course. It's like saying you're surprised that I'm babysitting. What? The kid's two? What? What's that brown stuff in your diaper? Poop. Who knew? It's a baby. They poop. Dogs whine. Dogs get dropped off to you, they can become total jerks. That's why we only board and we only do daycare with client dogs. That's why. We don't randomly take dogs in off the street. We're a private facility. So, you know, that's why. So, hey, Kim, this is Joelle. She's my intern.
Hi, Kim. All right. Montreal canine training for dogs who eat chew beds. I know you say they don't get a bed anymore. What if a client asks, can you train it not to chew beds? How do you address that situation?
Well, if I have a dog that chews beds in our place, they don't get a bed. Because this is the thing. This is the real question. This is the real question. What are you going to do at 2 in the morning when the dog eats the bed? How are you going to stop that? Are you going to be looking at a video camera and have a remote collar on it and then correct it for eating the bed at 2 in the morning and then 3 in the morning and then 4 in the morning and then 5 in the morning? No. So can it be corrected? Yes, it can be corrected. During a boarding train? No. I can't spend all that time on your dog. You know, do you want me to, I'd have to stay up all night. I would have to stay up all night. Now, historically, and also the dog could die. The problem is the dog could die. And then also, who pays for the beds? So if the owner wants to say, here's $1,000 just for beds, and I will sign a disclaimer knowing that my dog might die from eating and chewing up that bed, and you missed it because you happen to doze off at 3 or 4 in the morning. Sure, go ahead and do it and take a chance. But I got other priorities, like off-leash training your dog, rehabbing your dog. Now, guys, we're not magicians, by the way. We're not magicians. So what happens is, when you put together a good training program that's not just works on one thing, but it's like the whole thing, a lot of bad behaviors go away. But what happens if dog destroys a bed? Dog destroys a bed. Yeah, dog could die. Like, dogs have died from eating bedding. Next.
Adali, I hope I'm saying that right. How to crate train a dog who refuses to go in the crate?
Oh, that's easy. Put him in. So crate training is, a dog that refuses to go to a crate isn't a crate training issue. It's a getting the dog's ass in the crate issue. Crate training is different. It's like you haven't even gotten the dog in the crate yet. So you can't even crate train. Dolly, I'm being a little bit, flippant right now, if that's the right word for it. So what do? Any way you can. No, make going into the crate a wonderful experience. Okay. Tick tock, tick tock, tick tock. How about this? Go in the crate. Every dog that comes into our facility, what's the first thing they do? Besides go through thresholds, and they go outside to go to the bathroom. They go into a kennel or a crate. If they resist, they are going in. How? Pull them in, push them in, pick them up and put them in. Anything, any way you can do it, they're going in the crate. Then what happens is the more structure you do, dogs go in the crate just fine, but you'll do repetitions, 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 repetitions. So it doesn't take long. It takes minutes usually. Next.
Cecily, what is the best thing to say to a person who claims force is not required ever?
I wouldn't have a conversation with that person. I don't get into conversations with those people. They're living in an imaginary world. But force, people, all dog training is force. All dog training is force. Everything is force. Our whole world is force. We're forced to do everything in this world. They're living in what they're doing is this. You don't get into these conversations, but for you and I, for discussion, they're living in an imaginary world where it's filled with rainbows and unicorns. They have no fucking idea how the world works. They have no idea how anything in this world works. They don't even know where their vegetables come from. They don't know how the food came on the table. They don't know why it rains. They don't know what this is made of or how it's made. They have no idea about anything in the world at all. All they're doing is they're repeating something they read about that makes them feel like they care about dogs. That's all they're doing. They have no idea what they're talking about. They wouldn't know it from, they don't know anything. If they owned a dog and I watched them, if I said, I'm going to set up cameras all over your house and watch you for 24 hours, I will see you punish that dog all the time. And they'll say, no, I wasn't. I'll say, factually, yes, you were. Factually, yes, you were. They don't know what it means. All these people that are spouting never punish, they don't know what punishment is. They have no clue. I don't need any conversations with these people. What, like, why? I stay in my lane. I do my own thing. So you don't have conversations. Do you think they're going to believe you? Do you think they're going to have a discussion with you? All they want to do is argue with you. Remember, the more extreme someone is, the more unwilling they are to listen. All they want to do is be right. Always remember that. So, Jeff, how do you believe dogs are trained? The way that dogs are trained. Reward and punishment. Now, you can argue that if you want to. You can say that's not true if you want to. But it's fact. It's literally fact. So you can't, like, you can deny it. You can hide your head in the sand, but that's how dogs exist. That's how the world works. The world works through reward and punishment. That's how we work every day. Every day. So that's just an ideology which has a cult-like following that uses cult-like recruitment methods. Read the book. Right? To get people into the cult. So I don't pay attention to any of that bullshit. I got a world to change. Next.
Bushcraft Scott. Greetings from Scotland.
Hey, Scotland. I was just there.
Let's see. Scroll down too far. Lisa, how do you feel about a dog that has access to a doggy door during the day when owner's at work?
So Lisa, I'm not opposed to it, but it all depends on the dog. So if the dog's out there barking its head off all day, throw a bark collar on it, right? If you've got yourself a pushy, snotty dog, that's a lot of freedom. An aggressive dog, a lot of freedom. Separation anxiety, they'll never fix it. Housebreaking, they'll never fix it. But I'm fine with that. My dogs live outside most of the time. My dogs are probably not housebroken. Really, Jeff? You should be. You're a dog trainer. No, my lifestyle doesn't warrant having a housebroken dog. They're always next to me. My dogs are next to me right now. And after this, Joelle's doing a Facebook Live, but then after her Facebook Live, I'm gonna let them go out. I'm gonna take them out to the bathroom to go to the bathroom, and then they're gonna go to bed. Now, they sleep in my RV with me, and they're not in crates in the RV, and they don't soil in the RV. So I guess they do know how to, and as soon as they let them out, usually in a Walmart parking lot, because that's where we sleep, because I cross the country all the time, or I travel, I'm an RVer, I sleep in Walmart parking lots. They go to the bathroom on the grass, so I know they know to go to the bathroom outside, but I wouldn't let my dogs just walk around my house randomly. I wouldn't be surprised if they peed. Why? Because my lifestyle isn't conducive, and I haven't trained them to live in a home unattended, because I don't need them to. Because I decided to have a certain lifestyle with my dogs, where if my eyeballs are not on them, they're in a crate, or they're outside in a contained yard. Next.
Spinisper, when I was a vet tech, I assisted in surgery for a dog that ate his bed. He almost didn't survive. Yep. No bed for bed eaters.
Yep. And then also after what? So you also, yeah, did you ever get those zipper dogs in the zipper dogs? Zipper dogs. So a lot of people are like, what's a zipper dog? It's a dog that ingests so much stuff. It has to have so many damn surgeries. All the vets and the vet techs will say, man, it'd be easier to put a zipper on this dog. Believe it or not, that's a thing. And it's 35 in Texas. It's only $800 for that surgery, by the way. But it's here in Providence. It's about $2,800 to $3,500 for that surgery. And the dog can die on the table. They can, and eventually they run out of like inside stuff to like cut and move and shift. And eventually they're like, sorry, there's nothing else we can do for your dog. That's if you catch it in time and the dog never learns to not eat the bed. So no bed. Dogs sleep on the freaking ground. Next.
Koji B16, ACD blue healer, too excited, 10 months old. What is best?
Well, you have to learn how to properly punish. So you got yourself a cattle dog, blue healer mix, good dog. You can really harness that dog's energy and do lots of stuff. You'll never be able to tire it out, though. You'll never tire that dog out. and you don't need to tire it out. So I've got dogs lying down next to me right now. They've been down here for an hour and 15 minutes, and they're not tired, but there's nothing else for them to do in this room. So you need to learn how to get rid of arousal, and you need to learn how to properly punish and stop all that excitement, and then also teach your dogs how to do a lot of nothing when you don't want them to do nothing, whether they're tired or not. Teach the place command, learn how to bonk the dog, do those two things. Next.
Kim sent a bunch of kissy faces.
All right. I think Robin. Those are light. No, Kim definitely.
Is that what that is?
Kim is not sending me kissy faces.
What are those?
She's laughing.
Oh, those are laughing faces. Kim, okay.
Kim, she's in New Orleans.
Sorry, Kim.
She's in New Orleans. I don't have any beads, so she's not flashing me.
Okay, great.
And she's not sending me kissy faces. She's laughing.
They're weird on here. Those are not your typical emojis.
Right.
All right, Robin, two Q&As a week and over an hour long. Boy, are we all lucky.
Yeah, Robin, I know. I'm trying to butter her up for her own Facebook Live. So.
Chevy says, I started my 2019 Go Visit Jeff savings.
All right, cool. Nice. Unfortunately, I'm not cheap. I know. Sounds egotistical, but it is. I'm not.
And Lisa seconded that. She said, great idea, Chevy. Cecily, I use prong collars and I get harassed because I work in San Francisco.
Ironic, isn't it? The city of tolerance, right? Hey, San Francisco, guess what? Be a little bit more tolerating for people that are struggling and are a little bit different. Guess what? It doesn't make a difference where you live in this world. You will get harassed for a prong collar and a remote collar. Now, what are you going to do about it? What I say is nothing. Not a damn thing. If you don't like the collar that I use on my dog, tough shit. Get over it. Got it? If you ever feel threatened at all, then you do the same thing you would do. You know what I find really, really hypocritical? So many of my female followers and clients, which are 80% of my listening audience, YouTubers, podcasters, my clients are female. Most of the people that are harassing them, this is not a chauvinistic, sexist comment. This is fact. Therefore, it can't be chauvinistic or sexist because it's fact. You might not agree with it. You might not like it, but it's fact. And facts don't care about your feelings. Shout out to Ben Shapiro. Are harassed by other females. Females are running up to me as well. I don't get harassed by females, but men and women, and literally verbally abusing them and verbally attacking them. And sometimes physically attacking them. I find it appalling. I find it appalling in today's day and age with all this. Well, Jeff, it's a little bit different than sexual harassment. Well, if my wife's walking down the street or if Joelle's walking down the street and someone starts verbally abusing her and threatening her and she doesn't feel safe, what's the difference if it's about her dog or about anything else? Right? So if you come up to me and you want to make anti-Jewish comments, or if you want to come up to me and give me a hard time about my training tools and get in my face, what's the difference? There is no difference. You don't get a free pass because you think that you're caring about my dog. That's what the thing is. Oh, no, I'm allowed to do that to Cecily. I'm allowed to do it to Cecily because I'm a dog lover. Therefore, I can say something to Cecily because I'm a dog lover. Okay. Well, people that are overweight tend to cost more possibly in the healthcare system. Whether it's true or not, I don't know. And I'm not fat shaming here. So because I take care of my body and I barely use my healthcare, I've got the right to go up to you and yell at you for making bad health choices because my healthcare went up? Like, how ridiculous do we want to get now? I know, it sounds like, what does that have to do with it? It has a lot to do with it. It's all about personal space. It's all about common decency. And it's all about you are actually threatening another human being's safety. And it's not this microaggression bullshit where they feel threatened. You literally are threatening them. You're literally threatening them. I have people that are being attacked because of a prong collar on their dog under the guise that someone's like, oh no, because I'm a dog. They don't say this, but that's the big lie. Because they love dogs and care about dogs, they've got permission to do this. It's the biggest bunch of bullshit in the world. It's called being a not nice human being, is what you are. You're not a dog lover, you're not an animal lover, you're an asshole. And there's a huge difference to that. There's a huge difference out there. So, Cecily, you don't say anything. You don't get into discussions. You don't get into arguments. You carry mace with you. And if anybody gets in your space and you feel threatened, you neutralize the threat like you would with anything else in your life, with any other personal boundary, personal space issue. Because whether you don't like my religion or my sexual orientation, right, San Francisco, you don't have the right to do this. You don't have the right to get into my space and yell at me or say rude things to me. You don't. But I would just like stay in your lane, keep your thing. Anybody comes into your space, this is an intense show, huh?
Very.
Sorry, guys. If this is too intense for you. Yes, this is a dog training show.
Is it? This is like real world problems here.
Now, about that water shortage, this is what we do. All right, California. All right.
She also said she's investing in a keeper collar.
All right. Are you investigating a keeper collar because it's going to hide the prong collar? Just put a bandana on the dog. So I've trained dogs in Germany, which is illegal for me to do. I've trained dogs. These tools are illegal in Germany. They're illegal in lots of the world. People put bandanas on their dogs. Next.
Bushcraft Scott. My dog has a problem while he's on leash and trying to bully other dogs. He has improved lots since we got him. Should I correct him for overly focusing on other dogs and not me? He
Absolutely.
Also wears a prong.
Yes. No, it doesn't make a difference if he's got a prong on or not. Except for you have a way to correct him now. Absolutely correct him. Absolutely correct him. Yeah. Next.
Cecily said, thank you, Jeff. Adali, how to stop a dog from getting up on the couch?
Oh, that's easy. You make it suck. So any dog that's not under voice control in your house should have a leash on your dog. So I would keep a leash on the dog, and you would say the word off or no, pop the leash. Remote collar on your dog, remote collar, no, hit the button. Does it hurt? Yeah. At that level, I'm not going to gently ask. I'm going to tell you to get off the couch. Now, some people say, oh, no, lure it off with a treat. So train your dog to go on the couch, you mean? No. You're encouraging the dog to get off the couch. No, you're training your dog to get on the couch. In order to come off the couch to get the treat, the dog needed to get on the couch in the first place. That's what you just trained. I get on the couch, I come off the couch, and I get a treat. Or I get on the couch, and I'm only getting off for a treat. So what do? Grab the leash, off or no, pop. That's what you do. Guess what? Dog doesn't go on the couch. I'm not opposed to dogs on couches. I'm not opposed to sleeping with a dog. Next.
Montreal canine training, prong collars and dogs with very thick or hairy fur. Sometimes they get tangled and you don't get the snap release. How do you guys handle that? Can you talk a little bit about this?
We have dogs with really thick fur. We just make sure they're sized properly. You might have to, just make sure it's sized properly. And if it's up high, we've dealt with some Norwegian elk hound, long-haired Akita, Husky, some of them Russian mountain dogs, some of the mastiff breeds that are got lots of fur. They seem to be doing okay with them. It could be a sizing issue. Just use a 3-millimeter prong and make sure. Sometimes you want to make sure there's a little bit extra link in there instead of a little bit snug. Next.
KojiB16 says, thank you.
You're welcome.
Sean Diller, how do I stop a male dog from sniffing other dogs' butts?
Well, you got to tell the other dogs to stop, you know, tipping, number one. That's easy to do through punishment. Through punishment. So if the dog's on a leash, then who's the one holding the leash? You, right? Dog's off leash, remote collar. We use a dressage whip. So if you ever see us in the socialization yard using a dressage whip, bunker, video ideas, dressage whip. So in social, if we had a dog that was sniffing a dog's butt for too long, we would just give it a dressage whip. Well, actually, it's a stockyard whip, a little whip on the butt. The dog goes, whoa, that sucked. It's like, yeah, stop sniffing butt. Next, we charge extra.
Kim. Oh, great. Thanks for announcing that. I'm sorry, Kim. I didn't know any better.
Yep. Next.
No, I scrolled too far. Hungry Animal Foundation. The only harness I use are on my cats when I leash train them.
Yep. Next.
Cecily, the SPCA banned prong collars, so people are very outspoken about their opinions.
So, Cecily, I know the San Francisco SPCA is a joke. I saw their whole press release. They're a joke. They couldn't train a dog. I'm not bashing them, or maybe I am, but they're doing it to make money. All these SPCAs do, they're hypocritical. They couldn't train a dog for the life of them. Let's see them put out trained dogs. All they want is donations. They just want donations. That's all they want. It's all motivated by money. Nothing I do is motivated by money. Sure, I need to make a living, but they're lying to the general public. And guess what? Fact. There are people that work at the SPCA of San Francisco that are also on their board that are using shock collars and prong collars. Fact. I know who you are. It's all these people out there that are spouting don't use this stuff, including positive dog trainers themselves who are spouting never use a shock collar, never use a prong collar, never say no to your dog. I know they are going home with their own dogs and they're putting remote collars on their dogs the minute they walk in the door because they can't train their dogs. They're walking their dogs with prong collars. I know this. The list is too numerous to mention. Well-known trainers out there that have written books about positive reinforcement training are not doing it with their own dogs. It's all because it feels good and sounds good. Let them be outspoken. Let them be outspoken. That doesn't matter. That doesn't matter to you at all. If people are going to listen to them, no, what? They're God? And I'm not God. You don't have to listen to a damn thing I say at all. But what I'm saying isn't unique either. Millions and millions of dog owners in the United States and around the world use balanced dog training to train their dogs. Well, geez, they don't do it in zoos. What? That's the stupidest example. And we hear that a lot. Stupid example. Zoos. Give me a freaking break. Okay, if you didn't get your food unless you freaking performed something, like you'd start doing it too. Next.
Chevy, not to mention flights from New Zealand, my favorite place in the world, but so freaking far away from everything.
Oh, my God. I'll come to New Zealand. Chevy, you in New Zealand?
Too.
Oh, freaking fly me over there. Please. Let's do a seminar in New Zealand. Marta, where's Marta? Is Marta watching this? Marta. I think Marta's in Poland right now. Marta's from New Zealand. Marta, let's set something up in New Zealand. We'll do an Australia-New Zealand seminar.
Nice.
Yep.
Jamal, yep, I started a GoFundMe for T3 in October. I need to get there.
Jamal.
He's dedicated.
Yeah. All right.
Missy P.
Yep.
What is the best thing to say to strangers who want to touch your dog?
Say, thank you for asking, but no. So this is what you do. You say, thank you for asking, but no. And if they insist, then you do what you would do if somebody wanted to touch you. Got it? All right? You do the same exact thing. Except for if I asked to touch Joelle's boobs, she wouldn't say, thanks for asking, Jeff, But no, I imagine it would sound something like me, like, clutching my nuts bent over and her smiling, or she would sound something like my wife saying, go fuck yourself, Jeff.
Exactly.
Right? Like just because you ask. So it's not probably the best example, but about, like, I'm talking about just like personal space, just like personal space, you know? And by the way, guys, I know someone's going to write in afterwards. Geez, Jeff, Joelle is one of your interns. You're being really unprofessional with her. Like, I would never talk to her or anybody at work like this at all. No. We can separate things. This is all entertainment value. But also, it's Joelle.
Yeah, it's cool. Cool, Jeff.
It's Joelle.
Yeah. Nana Luke.
And I'm sure Joelle's husband's like.
He's probably sleeping.
He's probably like. Yeah, Jeff, it's okay with me.
Yeah.
He's like, I don't care.
Yeah, come on up.
Yeah, she's like, hey, I'm up in here in New Hampshire with all my buddies.
Exactly.
Drinking beer.
Having a great time.
Drinking beer on the boat.
Exactly.
He's like,
and I'm stuck here with Jeff. It's fine.
He's like, ladies, like, make sure you clean up them bikinis. Like,
exactly, right. Oh, boy. Nana Luke. Kia Ora, another Kiwi in the chat here. Nice.
Next.
Hungry Animal Foundation. The SPCA hasn't heard about Jeff.
Oh, yes, they have.
He could teach them, and they might whistle a different tune.
No, I cannot, and they're fully aware. Listen, guys, they're not interested. We've got to understand they don't care. They're not interested. It doesn't raise money. They don't have enough balls. They don't have the balls to say balanced training works. They have no spine. They have to say, oh no, these tools are bad. And then they'll list all the different science, which is a bunch of bullshit. It's called pseudoscience and it's called opinion. And it's not based on anything factual. The SPCA, like every other SPCA out there, they don't give a shit about any of this stuff. They don't really care. They don't care. They care about donations. Now, that's a wide paintbrush stroke. There's definitely some rescues and shelters that I work with that are open to it, that are different. But your average one, though, these are freaking sound bites from these people. These are just sound bites that they write, that they print out and they put out. And they just talk about it like, no, we don't believe in that. There are shelters that say you can't crate your dog. You can never say no to your dog. Give me a break. You're setting people up. You're setting people up for disaster. Next. We gotta stop soon.
Yeah. Nana Luke. Love your passion, Jeff.
Yep.
Cecily, Jeff should speak to the SFSPCA because they are brainwashing pet dog owners to think balanced trainers are abusive. Total BS.
No. You do it. But you don't speak to them. Guys, anytime anybody is so extreme like that, they're not interested in a conversation. When you have extremist groups, okay? When you have extremist groups, they cannot change their opinion. We have to understand that about extremist groups. They cannot change their opinion. You have to protect the ideology. The ideology is all that matters. You can't change it. It has to stay sacred. They're not interested at all. They're really not. That would be the biggest waste of my time and energy would be talking to the San Francisco SPCA. But if you want to have some fun and you want to play for donations, let's pull two dogs from your shelter. You give me a dog, I give you a dog, and let's get back together after 24 hours and see who's got a better trained dog. Let's do that. And the winner gets $10,000 that they can donate to the organization of their choice.
That'd be interesting.
I'm not willing to do that because my time is spent better. Other words, but if you want to have some freaking fun, put your money where your mouth is. I'm not challenging anybody here. I wouldn't do that. But there are trainers out there that have put that out there, that they're willing to put up $10,000. In fact, there's somebody out there that's put up $25,000 to like, let's go. Let's train dogs. Let's train family pets. Okay, not trick training, which I'm not against, not agility training, family pets. Let's do it. Real family pets in real homes. Let's do it. So it's all silliness. All this stuff is just silliness. There's your time is spent way better things, like doing a show like this and helping out the masses. Next.
Bushcraft Scott, I've never had anyone say anything about the prong collar on my dog. I guess most people in Scotland don't know what they are.
I got death threats in Scotland. There's a group over there. There's a group over in Scotland. It's public information, so I can mention it because they gave me death threats. The warning exchange. Yep. The warning exchange made death threats towards me as well as anti-Semitic threats towards me. We have the screenshots. Yep. Very hateful people. Most people there know about them. They might be in the UK. I know Scotland's part of the UK, guys. I'm aware. But they might be a bigger organization. Yep. Oh yeah. They're very hateful. They're very, very hateful. Yeah, I spoke before. I sat down with Scottish Parliament. I had a meeting with Scottish Parliament, and I helped craft their remote collar legislation when I was over there. And all the haters are like, oh, no, you didn't. It's like, yeah, yes, I did. I was there. Like, check the sign-in logs and check the – I sat down with, and it's all there. It's on public record. Yeah, that really went up their ass. Next.
Sean Diller. We've had some guy back us up against the fence because we said he could touch, I'm assuming couldn't touch our dogs. Yep. He was about 2 seconds from getting knocked out.
Yep, you should have just knocked him out. And I'm not a violent person, but it's like, damn, Sean, man, I feel for you. Next.
Lisa says, love it. Kim.
You go, girl.
You're gonna be okay. You're doing a great job. Thanks, Kim. Montreal canine training, when working aggressive fighting dogs together, especially same household dogs. Just to be clear, you use the dominant dog collar as well?
Yeah, we do. Yes, we do.
Yep. Nana Luke, name and shame them.
I'm not going to. I won't name and shame them. That's not my MO. Guys, you'll never see me comment. I don't even do it privately. Because I don't want my head there. You'll never hear me comment on other people's videos. People make hate videos about me. You never hear me like rebut them or make a defending video. You'll never see me like defending myself against all my hate. I'm not interested in that. Listen, there's two ways to build the biggest building. This is Gary Vaynerchuk. There's two ways to build the biggest building in town. There's one way is to knock all the buildings down around you, and then you're just the biggest building standing, or build the biggest building in town. I'm not trying to be the biggest dog training company or the best dog trainer. It's a metaphor. Also, there are people that wake up every day and they're like, how can I hurt as many people as possible? And there's people that wake up every day and go, how can I help as many people as possible? I'm the guy that says, how can I help as many as people as possible? And that's how I've decided to live my life. And I'm comfortable with that. And if other people want to wake up and they want to hurt as many people, and if they want me to be one of them, that's on them. That's 100% on them. That has absolutely nothing to do with me. It has nothing to do with me whatsoever. Oh, there's so many. Just go on to YouTube and look up my name. There's so many people that have made videos literally hating on me. I'm like, okay, if that's what you want to do with your time, like, you're looking like a jerk, not me. Like, okay. So that's not my – I would never – I would never name and shame anybody. Why? Because how does it make you feel when someone does that to you? Right? That's the question I always ask. How does it make you feel when someone does that to you? Most of us don't like it. So why would I do that to somebody else? That's all. I'm not mad at you, Nanalu, by the way. We gotta sign off. It's 1:40.
It's been a long one.
People are getting their money's worth tonight.
Yeah. Good show. Good questions.
Let's stop right here. We're in Scotland. I was in Glasgow. Or Glasgow. Glasgow? 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 And then I went to a bunch of wee villages. And I had a great time. All right, guys. Jeff Gellman of Solid Canine Training. I'm madly in love with you. Joelle, thank you for pinch hitting for Linda.
No problem.
Who's not doing well tonight at all. And it's not like she's hungover from the Taylor Swift concert last night. She went to the Taylor Swift concert. That's not what this is. She's just not doing well at all today. So anyway, guys, madly in love with you. You're all very special. Thank you so much. And I'll talk to you on Monday.
Right back at it.
Yeah.